my family drive everywhere. They have for pretty much my entire life. I enjoyed the classic Australian suburban upbringing, being driven to and from school pretty much every day of my childhood. I can count on one hand the number of times I caught the train before the age of 16. We just drove everywhere. I never really questioned this. I simply assumed that catching the bus or train was what you did if you couldn't afford a car or you couldn't drive. 91% of Australian households own at least one car, and 55% own at least two. Now, there are clear advantages to owning a car. You don't have to spend ages waiting, getting squished onto public transport, spending up to twice as long commuting from A to B. Cars allow you to drive wherever you want, whenever you want, in your own private space. Cars are a status symbol. They represent freedom. The desire to drive is so heavily ingrained in the Australian psyche that we're somewhat blind to its downsides. Obviously, there's the pollution. Then there's the sheer expense of driving. It costs the average Australian household $435 a week to drive. Most tragic of all, however, is the death. In 2023, 1,266 Australians tragically lost their lives on Australian roads. We don't truly grasp that each of these deaths isn't just a number. They are a real human being who had their entire life snatched away from them in an instant. And yet, without fail, each time one of these deaths is reported in the media, without fail, we just accept it. It almost feels inevitable. The ability to excuse all these downsides of driving as merely a fact of life is known as motonormativity. And we as a nation have done our very best to lock ourselves into a motonormative world. Our houses are large. Our cities are huge. Everything is spread so far apart, which pretty much gives us all no option but to drive everywhere. The ingrained motonormativity that I've just described pretty much keeps us all in our cars and away from public transport systems that are largely incompatible with urban sprawl. So city planners continue designing cities for cars, which keeps people in their cars, and the cycle continues. Meanwhile, negativity bias ensures that when we think of public transport, we think of delays and inconvenience. Sure, maybe driving is easier in Australia, but that's only because we've deliberately made driving easier. Because of all this, urban sprawl has consumed pretty much every corner of Australia. I'll always be grateful for my childhood, but growing up in a large house far from the local train station meant I pretty much had no choice but to rely on my parents to get me anywhere. There was never anything to do in my neighbourhood because to get to the good stuff, you'd have to drive. That all meant barely seeing my friends outside of school and not having a particularly social childhood. For children, the elderly, and those who cannot drive, cars don't equal freedom. So, public transport, buses, trains, metros, trams, and ferries all exist in some form in every large Australian city. It moves people much more efficiently, moving far more people per square metre than by car. Because using public transport involves a lot more walking, it also leads to substantially better health outcomes. In Sydney, at least, because of the OPAL travel cap, you'll never spend more than $50 a week using public transport. It also offers you a lot more flexibility. You don't have to stress about finding parking, and you can actually do stuff while moving from A to B. Heck, I actually wrote a lot of this speech while I was on the train. But you know what? Let's hand it over to you guys, the audience. So this is a serious question. Put up your hand if you took the bus or the train or any other form of public transport here today. Okay, I was prepared for this. That's a very good number. Very happy to see that. I am convinced you guys are the outliers. Well done. Because trust me, when it comes to a lot of these things, people drive. And let's be completely fair. If Australia's public transport systems were as efficient, reliable, frequent, fast, and just outright impressive as the public transport system in, say, Singapore, I bet pretty much everyone in this audience would have put up their hand. 7 in 10 Singaporeans live just a 10-minute walk from the local MRT station. That's pretty impressive for a country with less train stations than Sydney, despite having the same population. So, what is Singapore's secret? Transit-oriented development. Singapore has spent decades building up into the sky, largely due to being such a land-scarce nation. But crucially, this has allowed them to concentrate their populations around MRT stations. Logically, a station with, say, 10,000 residents located within a 10-minute walk will be able to run services more frequently than one with, say, only 500 people. Consequently, Singapore has been able to construct an MRT network that runs services much more frequently than the average Sydney train line, and services far more people. It runs more reliably, because when more than half the country relies on it every single day, it needs to be reliable. All my Singaporean relatives primarily get around the island by public transport, and that includes my 85-year-old grandma, because they can. Town centres in Singapore are alive and bustling with hawkers, shops and parks because there's always people near them. Australian cities cannot hope to achieve this level of connectivity without making some sacrifices. Suburbs with a low density population will always be somewhat incompatible with bustling town centres. But this correlation isn't immediately clear to most, and it is a difficult pill for Australians to swallow. Decades of the Australian dream have subconsciously taught us that living in an apartment or townhouse is innately inferior to living in a house, founded upon fears of noise, overcrowding, a loss of privacy, and a general prejudice against tall buildings. This is frankly at odds with everything that I've seen. Some of the best parts of our cities, like Chatswood and like Parramatta, are those with great public transport, with well-designed density, with vibrant communities, and that's no coincidence. Imagine being able to step out of your home and walk to the local train station, the grocery store, the shops, and more, all within just minutes. These places are life-changing for those who cannot drive. With everyone living much closer together, it's suddenly much easier to see your friends and family. Where cars push people further apart, public transport brings us all closer together. The good news is that our behaviours are changing. Millennials and Zoomers account for 62% of all public transport patronage in Australia, despite only being 39% of the population. Many young Australians like myself, who grew up in car-dependent suburbia, are seeking a different, better future. We want to start building our cities around public transport again. We want to shift a culture that has viewed driving as the ideal for generations. So, the next time you're going somewhere, consider taking public transport. At least give it a chance. It may genuinely surprise you. Or maybe it'll still have some way to go. Rome wasn't built in a day, and neither was the Sydney Metro. But this should be the future that we want for Australia. Because this isn't just about the way that we move. It's about the way that we live.